It's a great joy to welcome you to the chapel for our first service of the new school year from the Stamford Endowed Schools. We're back, and it's wonderful to have our community around us again. We are still doing things differently, but seeing faces and hearing voices again is a great morale booster, and we realise again, if we really did need reminding, the importance of our school community. This week is our new year, our Advent. We look forward to what is to come, knowing that as we go through the year, we will build to the culmination of next summer, which will hopefully be much more fulfilling than the last. Today we have our choir leading our worship, and our speaker is the principal, Mr Will Phelan. It is one of the traditions at the Endowed Schools that at the beginning of the year, the principal gives the first sermon of that year. And it is our practice here to begin the service with our gathering prayer. Lord, speak to us that we may hear your word. Move among us that we may behold your glory. Receive our prayers that we may learn to trust you. Amen. Our hymn and anthem this morning are led by the chapel choir, and our hymn today is Lord of All Hopefulness. When we talk about community, we mean more than a collection of bodies doing something together. Who we are and what we are matters. We will hear more about this later. We always need to keep in sight that humanity is more than a mass of biological movement. Humanity is imbued with God's presence and love. Our reading this morning reminds us of our humanity, frail and challenged, yet beautiful and reflecting God's nature. It is from Romans chapter 12 and is read for us by our new school chaplain, Ben O'Neill.
Don't just pretend to love others, really love them. Hate what is wrong, hold tightly to what is good. Love each other with genuine affection and take delight in honouring each other. Never be lazy, but work hard and serve the Lord enthusiastically. Rejoice in our confident hope, be patient in trouble, and keep on praying. When God's people are in need, be ready to help them. Always be eager to practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Don't curse them. Pray that God will bless them. Be happy with those who are happy, and weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with each other. Don't be too proud to enjoy the company of ordinary people. And don't think you know it all.
Our anthem this morning is Almighty and Everlasting God by Orlando Gibbons.
Almighty
Our speaker this morning is Mr Will Phelan, the principal of the Stamford Endowed Schools.
Good morning, everybody. At the beginning of this new school year, algorithms. As you can imagine, I've heard quite a lot about these over the last few months. They govern every part of our life, how money is made, how people move around cities, how food is ordered, and as I found out, how insurance pays out on fires. And how, or at least I thought how, examinations this year were going to be determined. Even McDonald's in the United States now employs an algorithm which predicts what you're going to order by analysing your car at the drive-thru before you say anything. And apparently, it's 75% accurate. Clearly, if you're in a big SUV, you'll have three kids in the back who'll all want Happy Meals. Now in school, the question, what is an algorithm, is taught. But do you know what an algorithm is, really? Considering so many parts of our lives seem to be governed by them, I turned to Key Stage 1 BBC Bite Size to find some definitions and examples with which to educate us all today. Okay, so you use a code, tell a computer what to do. Before you write code, you need an algorithm. An algorithm is a list of rules to follow in order to solve a problem. And algorithms need to have their steps in the right order. Think about an algorithm for getting dressed in the morning. What if you put on your coat before your jumper? Your jumper would be on top of your coat, and that would be silly. I told you it was Key Stage 1. When you write an algorithm, the order of the instructions is very important. And of course, when you put it like that, it makes plenty of sense. Other examples could be the algorithm for finding the park, baking a cake, building a toy like an Airfix model. But if the instructions aren't clear, as I find all the time with IKEA, or something is broken, it won't work. Now, computers are better at this than us, and you really should see my attempts at IKEA, and my heart sinks a little bit when I think of all the things I will have to build again now, after the fire. Of course, this implies that it is simply a case of following a list of instructions in the right order in an algorithm. Great, but what if these instructions are in a different language, Or what if in Kolkata, where a computer programmer has written an algorithm for the London transport system and has never seen the London transport system at work? Won't that lead to problems? Also, when you set up an algorithm for a task, it's fed with prior data which has been interpreted by humans, who are naturally, consciously or unconsciously biased. Doesn't this mean that this then makes the program biased? Well, possibly. And here's the nub of the argument. If algorithms are going to be useful in the UK, we need, in some cases, people who are experienced in the UK to be writing them. They will understand that there are cultural differences here that somebody in another country just wouldn't think of. So it's important we develop our own computer programmers and mathematicians who can write these programs. And I know there'll be plenty of mathematicians listening to this morning. It's no good relying on other people to write these and us relying on them. We need to be able to write these ourselves, and even with that, algorithms can go wrong. We know that the Ofqual algorithm for GCSEs and A-levels would only work if it was checked manually that schools were following the Ofqual instructions. If you're in a very small school with low numbers of students, you could fiddle the algorithm if you wanted to. So algorithms are only good when they're complemented by our human qualities. They cannot work on their own. And where algorithms work on their own without any being a part of this process, they can go wrong. And here are some examples. Facebook researchers recently noticed that two of their artificially intelligent robots were no longer using coherent English to communicate. Interestingly, when the researchers dug deeper, they found out that the AI agents, Bob and Alice, were speaking a variation of English because reportedly they had deduced that English language lacks reward. Don't tell Mr. Zacharias. Microsoft's chatbot, Tay, was meant to be an experiment in AI and machine learning, but it only took 24 hours for the bot to turn racist. Tay was supposed to speak like millennials, learning from the people it interacted with on Twitter and the messaging apps Kik and GroupMe. But the transgression from humans are super cool to Hitler was right were absolutely disastrous. Well, you can blame the AI or chatbots, but actually in a sliding scale, it gets worse. In 2016, for an international beauty contest, which was to be judged by machines, thousands of people from across the world submitted their photos. Beauty AI was to work on the basis of an advanced algorithm free of human biases to find out what true beauty looked like in the eyes of the computer. But things went wrong very quickly, as the algorithm started associating skin colour with beauty and picked winners solely on the basis of race. There have been several cases in the US where an algorithm-based bot has accidentally identified a regular innocent citizen as a criminal and has automatically suspended their driving license. Similar cases have also occurred at airports all over the world where innocent people have been recognised, in inverted commas, as terrorists. Knight Capital, a firm that specialised in executing trades for retail brokers, took $440 million in cash losses in 2012 due to a faulty test of new trading software and its algorithm. And finally, and most seriously, after the Air Sweden 294 plane crashed in 2016, investigators were able to determine that the Air Data Inertial Reference Unit, or ADIRU, device that tells the plane how it's moving through space, had begun to send erroneous signals, but they couldn't figure out why. Now, here at Stamford, there are four things which I talk about which we're preparing our Stamfordians for. Firstly, to prepare children educationally for the next stage of their lives, building upon the broad curriculum and introducing new ways to analyse, think, and interpret information. Secondly, to prepare them for a fulfilling workplace where humanity complements and supports automation. Thirdly, to prepare them for life and family, probably the most important job they will undertake. And fourthly, prepare them for meaning and happiness. Now you'll note that I've spoken about humanity complementing and supporting automation, and I think that juxtaposition is right. And here in Chapel, and everywhere, this is our God-given humanity. AI and these algorithms aren't just going to become part of their lives, they're here already. And we have to make sure that we are able to write these programmes for our benefit and for others, and to build in our humanity and all of those things we are in that process. And even in a more developed AI environment, there will always be the need for our humanity in the future. There are lots of jobs which can be done by AI, which will make things better for us. Similarly, there are lots of jobs that will best be done by us. And we need to be able to balance this. For a final example, how brilliant to use an algorithm and AI to search through millions of treatment plans for somebody who is seriously ill and find the one that works for that person with their background, physical attributes and lifestyle. But who tells that person they're ill and supports them throughout? A human. And God gave us that humanity. We need to work together. Good morning to you all.
Our prayers are led by Ben O'Neill.
Loving God, our Creator, our Saviour, our Companion, bless this journey of a new school year that we now undertake. Refresh our souls and renew our spirits as we begin a new year of education. We welcome those who are new to this community and ask that you strengthen them to share the wonderful gifts you have given them. Lord, make our hearts pure and guide our hearts and minds. God of wisdom and might, we praise you for the wonder of our being, for mind, body and spirit. Be with all our students as they begin a new school year. Bless them and their teachers and staff. Give them strength and grace as their bodies grow, wisdom and knowledge to their minds as they search for understanding, and peace and zeal to their hearts. We ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We pray for our whole community of students, families and staff. Let us all be inspired by the spirit of learning, living and loving, that together we may be inspired to play our part in the world. Bless our lives together, that we may learn what is most precious to you, and the wisdom to live it. This we pray in the name of our Saviour, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And so we pray the prayer that our Saviour himself taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
And our blessing. Eternal God and Father, by whose power we are created, and by whose love we are redeemed, guide and strengthen us by your Spirit, that we may give ourselves to your service, and live this day in love to one another and to you, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen.